Hello and welcome to Global Review. I am Sachin Chaturvedi. We bring to you every week detailed analysis of what has happened at the global level. But as always, first, let's have a look at the headlines. North and South Korea signed Pyongyang declaration, taking steps towards denuclearization. Ethiopia and Eritrea signed peace deal to aid regional security brokered by Saudi Arabia. Venezuela gets 5 billion assistance from China, giving stake in oil industry this time. China-Nepal's second joint military exercise being launched very soon. Russia and Turkey agree for a buffer zone in Syria. IMF has some doubts whether they would be supporting UK economy in their Brexit efforts. China adds $60 billion worth of US products under its tariff war that's going on after US imposed $200 billion worth of tariffs on Chinese goods. Friendship Pipeline will supply high-speed diesel and ensure a sustainable, eco-friendly energy supply to Bangladesh. Today in our discussion, we would be picking up India's response to the global financial volatility. You may recall in the last episode, we discussed at length how global financial volatility is coming in our section across the globe. India has come up with a very balanced approach in terms of how other countries are responding and what should be India's response. Let's have a look at this report.
Amid global currency volatility, the Indian rupee, which has declined by 6% against the dollar since August, may retrace up to 3% by December as the Indian government announces its five-pronged policy actions to prevent the currency freefall. The strategy includes removal of withholding tax on rupee-denominated masala bonds, relaxation for foreign portfolio investors, curb non-essential imports, limit the widening of the current account deficit and check the rupee fall. Trade deficit and a declining rupee continues to add pressure on the current account, and hence government's actions towards managing the deficit and increased inflow of foreign funds can have a positive impact on the rupee. Currency traders and portfolio investors are seeking more stringent measures such as interest rate hikes or creating special dollar window for oil companies, along with further clarity on the five government proposed actions. Foreign investors are in a wait-and-watch mode as emerging market currencies continue to decline and more than 49,000 crore rupees has been pulled out by overseas investors from the Indian market since January. As compared to other emerging markets, India's non-financial debt as a percentage of its GDP is at 15%, much lower than Turkey's 70% and Argentina's 54%. This helps retain India's credibility to an extent in the financial markets. However, external factors such as increasing crude oil prices, which will touch $80 per barrel mark, and escalating US-China trade war continue to affect the Indian rupee. Experts have urged the Reserve Bank of India to continue focusing on inflation, targeting to retain investor confidence, and the government to look at the combined deficit of center and state, which is at 7% of the GDP. Internally, the government is also undertaking banking sector reforms to manage non-performing assets and strengthen India's macroeconomic fundamentals. Three major public sector banks have been proposed for amalgamation, giving a boost to banking operations.
With the financial volatility coming across all our newspapers headlines every day, people are worried in terms of what should be government's response or what could have been the response that they could have seen by the government. It's important, and that's why in two episodes we have been discussing and bringing out the global interlinkages that this crisis offers. To discuss some of the issues associated with this, we are joined in this panel today by Dr. Alok Shiel, one of the eminent policy makers in this area. We are also joined by Mr. K. Badrinath, the commentator and associate editor with Financial Chronicle, and Professor Sriram Cholia. So Badri, I must ask you, and we should begin discussion with you in terms of how you look at government response to this financial volatility. This is not confined to India alone, as some people are presuming. It is, as we are seeing, is bringing in almost more than 18 currencies with it. How you look at this?
See, last week, the government has rolled out a set of measures. One can safely say that rupee has performed the worst in terms of emerging economy currencies. But at the same time, the response that has been made by the government is very modest in the terms that very conservative policy seems to have been rolled out. One, I say conservative for the simple reason that from January the slide in rupee was huge.
Yes.
And secondly, the oil prices, the crude prices, which have gone beyond the $80 per barrel, has also impacted the economy. Third part is the currency, trade wars that have erupted.
Between US and
US
China.
US and China and elsewhere.
And then the other EU part of it.
External factors seems to have been triggering a lot of trouble back home.
Mm.
And my guess is they have set up five measures rolled out. And let's see how it works, because we do not know whether this is going to work, given that, your foreign
exchange reserves are also challenged.
Foreign investment flows are, being pulled out,
right.
It's reversing. And second, we are forced to put up restrictions on imports. And third measure that the finance minister announced is easing the external commercial borrowing so that the volatility in rupee is trimmed.
Exactly. Sriram, this also is linked with our own preparedness. And as finance minister has very forcefully articulated in terms of addressing the internal reforms that are required, the banking sector and many other measures. We discussed that and then in the last episode of this very program, we had Ratin Roy elaborating the specific measures that have been taken. How you look at these possibilities out?
I think, Sachin, the economies that are growing slowly or are in recession are likely to be more vulnerable to this. On the positive side, 7%, 7.5%, or possibly even 8% next quarter, that gives us some confidence. And as your report mentioned, our external debt as a percent of GDP is only 15%, unlike some of the other emerging market economies. That said, I think that we must activate the BRICS currency swap agreement.
Hmm.
See, we had all pulled in about 100 billion, especially for this kind of scenario where almost all the BRICS countries are on the receiving end of this currency route that we are witnessing. In fact, Russia, the ruble, the South African rand, Chinese yuan, of course, is relatively doing better. But almost all of us are in a soup because of this. So I think we must try and look for means for small plurilateral groups which can come together and find ways to shield ourselves from the volatility of the dollar and the fluctuation, because ultimately if there is a capital outflow, it means that resources and productivity is also going to slow down in these countries.
That's
so
right.
It's a financial emergency which we should
do resources. Dr. Alok Shiel, we would be discussing in the next segment the G20 and its associated imperatives. How you look at the currency volatility at this stage, And during your finance ministry days and in the early years of G20, this was one of the major issues that other countries were grappling with. India was largely, people were saying, was insulated from the global recession that was on during 8 and until actually 12. How you look at the current developments?
You know, this the sharp increase in capital flows is also linked to the issue of global imbalances. And when you have global imbalances, you have, you know, capital flowing across borders. And this is something which the G20 has tried to address, but I think it is something which is going to stay. For instance, China's current account deficit has declined, but, you know, Germany's has increased. So these imbalances will remain. That is one. The other issue driving capital flows, and which I think is less discussed, is U.S. monetary policy.
Yeah, and when, its impact on...
Yes, because once it goes into tightening mode, increasing rates, then capital flows out of emerging markets. And the other way around, when it loosens policy, then capital flows to emerging markets in search of yields.
Badri, can we have a quick comment from you before we break into...
See, my guess is China and Germany can manage their you know, current account deficits. You don't have the elbow room at all.
Yeah.
The flexibility that Finance Minister Arun Jaitley has is very limited, especially in an election year where you need to do a lot of development spending.
That's right. That's
right. If that is the case, you can't afford that at all.
On that positive note, we stop here and we would come back with much more analysis of these interdependencies. Don't go away. Welcome back. In this segment today, we are going to talk about the issues that G20 would be taking up for discussion in our section, Beyond the News. The 13th episode of the whole exercise that is on for last 13 days in terms of managing global governance, bringing in stability in our financial and other associated areas of development pillar, is likely to be hosted by Argentina in next few weeks. What are the key issues? Let's have a look at this report.
The Group of 20, that is G20 Trade and Investment Ministerial Meeting, took place at Mar del Plata, Argentina on 14 September, focusing on current and future trade prospects, ongoing trade conflicts, the global agriculture supply chains, openness of markets, transfer of technology and digitally enabled trade. The G20 ministers asserted the need to improve the World Trade Organization in light of the fresh tariffs being imposed between US and China. Commerce and Industry Minister Suresh Prabhu called for collective action to revitalize the WTO while retaining its core principles of consensus building, inclusiveness and transparency. The ministerial meeting was in lineup to the upcoming 13th meeting of the G20 world leaders at Buenos Aires, Argentina on 30th November 2018. Under the Argentine presidency, the agenda priorities for the G20 summit are the future of work, infrastructure for development and sustainable food future. Over the course of 2018, 45 meetings have been held in Argentina amongst think tanks, working groups, ministers covering issues related to agriculture, gender equality, digital economy, education, employment, trade and investment and energy. The G20 brings together the world's leading 20 industrial and emerging economies and cover 66% of the world population, 75% of international trade, 80% of global investment and 90% of the global economic output. The aim of the G20 meetings is to recognize the different role of the drivers of the economy and broaden the scope of international economic and financial cooperation. Launched in the background of the 1997 Asian financial crisis, the primary mandate of the G20 is to manage and avert international financial crisis. Previous meetings have focused on global trade, climate change, as well as picked up issues of terrorism in light of the war against the Islamic State group.
So what started with primarily after the 1997, what was called as East Asia financial crisis, we now see more and more efforts coming up when it was scaled up at the heads of the state level. The various presidencies that were there have made their own bit in terms of expand the agenda, trying to bring in more and more actors. In case of South Korea, we found that the development pillar was added to this whole exercise. Canada and France continued. France's contribution was to bring agriculture in a major way as part of the G20 agenda. In Germany, we found more efforts were made in terms of bringing in Africa in a major way. Trade, investment, and how we bring in Africa. China's presidency added sustainable development goals as a major pillar of the work program on G20. So, amidst all these different priorities of different presidencies, what would be Argentina's priority? As our report said, the future of the work is one of their major priorities at this stage in terms of coping up and enabling countries to cope up with the development challenges that the new technologies would be posing. My first question to you, Dr. Alok Shiel, and you have been one of the key experts in the government. You have handled these issues, of course, many years back, but you have been advising and have been part of this whole deliberations that were on right at the inception of the G20 and its idea when it evolved. How you look at this grouping coming up in terms of its ability to cope up with the key global challenges?
Well, the G20, as you had indicated, was originally set up in response to the East Asia crisis. It was primarily a meeting of finance ministers and central bank governors. And well, it was not, a particularly high profile group. The high profile group was the G7.
That's right.
And all major crisis issues would be not only handled by them, I suppose they were discussed in all fora, but everybody looked at this fora for global leadership. But when the global financial crisis hit, it was felt that there were very few global platforms where all the important stakeholders required to address the crisis were present. And I think when they looked around, they found that it was the G20, because the G7 famously excluded China. And if you see the debate over the causes of the crisis, it has centered around two things. One is, financial deregulation.
That's right.
And the other was global imbalances. Now, you could not address the issue of global imbalances without China. And so the G20, acquired prominence as the premier forum for international economic cooperation. But I get a sense that as the crisis has receded, and if you recall in the initial stages it was felt that the advanced economies, their economies were collapsing, the financial sector was collapsing, but growth held up quite well in the major emerging markets.
That's right.
China as well as India.
Right. Yeah.
And it was felt that, it is the global economy was decoupling and people were looking towards these economies to take it out of the crisis. Now, the way things have panned out has not really happened that way. At present, if you look, growth really is strongest in the United States. Both China and India, growth, and in emerging markets.
Even Brazil and South Africa, you find lagging behind.
But how do you see, in terms of the current priorities? So once their growth has declined, so I think I feel the focus is shifting back to the G7 for major decision making, and that used to be a very sensitive issue in the G20.
That's right.
The G7 took pains to show that the major decisions are being taken in the G20 and not behind the scenes by the G7. I'm not too sure how things have panned out now.
Yeah, Shiram. The geopolitics is equally important when we talk of G20 and the issues, and as our report showed, the development is equally important. The semantics in terms of bringing in key priority areas, but also the optics in terms of having Africa, though not officially at the table, but definitely on the table. So, how you see G20 unfolding in the weeks to come?
I think, Sachin, the trade war cloud is looming over G20. And Mar del Plata, they, you know, we saw that the U.S. pushed for what they're saying reform of WTO, while, you know, developing countries and the emerging powers are concerned about the barriers that are freshly coming from the U.S. and to a lesser extent from the EU. So that division remains. And if you see, the Trump administration is moving increasingly towards bilateral one-on-one deals and to bypass the G20 and even the WTO. They have done one with Mexico recently, and they are also doing one with Canada as part of the NAFTA revamp. Likewise, they are looking for one-on-one deals. India has apparently also offered to have a dialogue with the US on a bilateral settlement of the trade dispute. So the G20 really, in that sense, is in a bit of a crisis mode, because they were supposed to be the steering mechanism both for freer trade and for open borders, and also for the development agenda,
this,
which you mentioned.
Dr. Shil, actually counters the point that you mentioned in terms of leadership going back to G7. Do you agree with this point in terms of changing decision making process or its priorities?
Well, I, you know, you
getting more into bilateral.
You would get a, you know, one gets a sense of these things while attending G20 meetings. And as I was telling you, when I attended G20 meetings, I got a sense that, you know, there was a great sensitivity to this issue, when the G7 summit was timed, what did the communique say. I don't know how things have panned out now, but I just suspect that with the declining fortunes of the emerging markets, they are more now seen to be more crisis prone as the advanced economies have recovered. So I would imagine that, you know, the G7 feels that they have less need for the other G20 countries for in steering the global economy. And coming to trade, this was always an important issue in the G20. First, the focus on global imbalances. And secondly, it had become a joke in the G20 that every communique would say that would call for a successful negotiation of the Doha round.
Exactly.
And it had reached such a stage when the Sherpas started deliberating whether you should include the Doha round at all in the communiques. And then you were in a trap. If you did not include it, it would mean that the G20 has given up on the Doha round.
That's
and
right.
If you included it, people would laugh and say the G20 can do nothing about it.
Exactly.
And
with this, we would
even
have
at
to,
that time, the WTO, it was felt that the real action on trade was taking place in the G20 and not in WTO. But now it feels that even the real action is not taking place in the G20, but as pointed out by Dr. Choralia, in bilaterals.
In bilateral. So with that, we would have to come to our last segment, Book of the Week. And today we have picked up Francisco and Lewis' book focusing on international trade, capital flows, and economic development. This excellent book by Francisco and Lewis captures the essence of theoretical nuances of how capital mobilization, its governance, should be looked at from the larger theoretical perspective, where you bring in all different sectors. It's pity that when the book came out, we had already lost Lewis, but the book is a great contribution, Sriram.
Definitely, Sachin. I think the main point which I got from it was there's a lot of volatility in capital flows.
That's right.
And developing countries, they show, you know, year on year, or sometimes even every 5 years or so, the trend is they receive a lot, and then there's also a lot of capital flight that is going out. And right now, we seem to be in another such phase, as we discussed in the first segment of today's show, where, you know, capital outflows are directly linked to the pressure on the currencies of emerging markets.
Yeah.
So what they're saying is, they're investigating as economists, is FDI good for developing countries? Does it actually produce growth? They say, yes, if the governance in developing countries is strong, yes. But still, the threat of capital flight is there, because if there are no proper capital controls, you always have a situation in this globalized era where they say capital votes with the feet and leaves. And then what? You know, you could have a hollowing out effect. So the hot money flows that have happened is what they are challenging. And they are saying that, you know, FDI per se is maybe good, but only if it is accompanied by, you know, some degree of controls and also better governance locally, because there's a corruption, for example, can mitigate the impacts of FDI into developing countries. So capital flows,
so better governance, exactly, better governance and convergence of sectors, that I think is the key message, both in terms of the G20 moving forward, but also from the book of the week. I thank you for your continued input and support. You are seeing my Twitter handle on your screens. Do send us your comments and ideas, and we would be back to you next week, same time. Till then, goodbye. Thanks.